Okay, let's start our first lab session in AgEcon 305. Remember, this class, this online lab that you're doing, replaces the Friday session from class, so we won't be meeting this Friday. This is our third class meeting of the week, so this is week one's lab. Yeah, so just an overview to give you an idea of what these labs will be, at least what this lab will be, is a demonstration showing some basic Excel functions, how we might look at the data, and this material, this cutout here are the objectives or sort of the list of things that this lab demonstration should accomplish. So we should get some experience looking at how to do frequency analysis, how to use the if function, some descriptive statistics, a special function called the average if. We'll talk a little bit about data types, character versus and string data versus numerical data, how to use if statements to convert one type of data to another. Then we'll close out, which is something that's mostly for your assignment, to build a cross-tab or cross-tabulation using two categories of information with a nested if statement, and then the last part will graph the outcomes, graph the outputs with histograms. Okay, so let me open my spreadsheet. So you have this, this spreadsheet is provided with the lab. It has 18 observations. The first column is the school attended, the second is IQ, and then the third is gender. And if you look down here at the bottom, I'm in the sheet called Demo Data. If you look at the bottom here, it gives you the data code. So under school attended, number one, if it says one, it means they attended Purdue. Number two means they decided to attend Indiana University. The IQ column tells us the intelligence quotient or some measure of intelligence, with 100 being the average, right? So we talk about things over 100 being above and below being below average. And then in the last category, an F indicates female, M indicates male. And so that's our data. I'm going to go ahead and use the move or copy instruction or option here to make a copy of this demo data, so that in case I mess up, I can always go back and get the original data from another sheet. So if you hit that move or copy and then put create a copy, then Excel just creates a new version. It just says demo data, and in parentheses it says 2 now. And so I can rename this maybe working or something like that, because this is the data sheet that I'm going to do all my work in. But if something goes wrong or I lose this, I'll always have the demo data version there saved so I can go back and see what's going on. Okay, so I said the first thing we were going to do is look at frequency, right? So we see this data, and we could go through on a small data set like this and say how many people went to Purdue, how many went to IU. We could look at this and say how many male, how many female. But we want to learn to use functions to do this sort of thing. So the way to do that in Excel is the frequency function. And so this is an article from Excel's help file that says how to use the frequency function. And basically it calculates how often values occur. Basically, what the syntax or the way to implement the frequency function is to type frequency. So I'll show you this. We'll demonstrate this frequency in a cell, and that means we're going to use the frequency function, and then it needs two inputs. These things inside parentheses are inputs or arguments for that function. So the first one is data array, and the second one is bins array. So the data array tells us. It points Excel to the listing of your data that you want to calculate the frequency for, And then the second piece is something you have to provide. It's called the bins array. It says what kind of bins, what kind of categories do you want this data calculated into? And so let me open my spreadsheet up here and I'll demonstrate the use of the frequency function. But the first thing I'm going to do is put the school bins right here. So one and two, if you look down here at the codes, one will be the count for the number of people attending Purdue, and two will be the count for observations that attended IU. And so to put in any function, we always start with an equal sign. So you type the equal sign and then you start typing the word, and once you get to FREQ like I have, it gives you the option to just go ahead. The only function that's left in Excel's dictionary of functions is the frequency function. So if you click it, double click it, it fills in the frequency function and reminds you that you need to give me both a data array and a bins array. Okay, and so to get the data array in, I just move over here and highlight all of the school attended data. So these are all the recordings of information about what school was attended. We need to put a comma in, and now we can fill in the bins array, which is the thing I created right here, the listing of categories that we can expect to see in the school attended category. Close that parentheses and hit enter, and you get 9. Okay, and so the frequency formula, or the frequency function in Excel, is special. And maybe you remember this from maybe AggieCon 202 or some of your own work with Excel, because you put the frequency function in one cell, but it really needs to apply to more than one. It needs to count the number of observations that attended Purdue in this column, in this row, but it needs to calculate another one, and we've not entered any function down here. And so the way to overcome that, or the way to finish out this array formula, is to highlight both of the cells next to the bins, and then if you hit F2, what it does is it expands the formula to the array, to the full two cells that we just highlighted, and then to fill in all the cells that are part of the array, the array formula, you hit Control, Shift, and Enter at the same time, and you see that it filled in the rest of my information. Okay, so now I have school bins 1 and 2, and if I wanted, I could type Purdue University, Indiana University there. It says I have, out of 18 observations, 9 went to Purdue, 9 went to IU. Okay. So that's our first test, our first application of the frequency function. Let's do another one for gender, where we have another category of data. So we could go M and F. And if we apply the frequency function, so type it, fill it in, get the data from the gender column, get the bins right next to it, and hit enter, and it says 0. It says there's 0 M's. And then if I highlight both cells to fill in the array, hit F2 to populate the array with the frequency function, and then hit Control Shift Enter, it says 0 again. So we've hit a problem in our data that we should stop and think about. So if you go to the next slide, in the handout or in the PowerPoint, you'll see I've got another cutout or another screen grab from Excel's help file that talks about character data types. So this is actually referring to Visual Basic, but it's the same in Excel. So character data types are the ones that are data that use a letter rather than a number, so it doesn't have any numerical value. So here are my notes on this. Character data is just what it sounds like. It's when you record information using a single character of input that can't be calculated to be some number. Okay, it doesn't have any numerical value. If you put multiple characters together, like if I had put written Purdue into the database or into the data column, or Indiana, that we would call that a string because it's a multiple characters used together. Numerical inputs are actually strange or unique because they could actually have real values. They could mean the values, or they could just mean this is the character I'm using to represent one category versus the other. So in the Purdue versus IU listing, we put 1 for Purdue, 2 for Indiana, but we didn't have to. We could have put P versus I, right? Or we could have written the word Purdue versus Indiana. And so it's just coincidence that we actually ended up with some numbers there that the frequency function could deal with. So typically other Excel and other programs will convert numeric data to real value as soon as you try to use a mathematical function on it. So that's important to keep in mind. Other programs, I don't know what kind of data manipulation programs you might have seen, work fine with character data, and there's probably a way to make Excel work fine with it, but we're going to use another process. We're going to recode our data, and so I'll come back to this if function in just a moment. Okay, so what we want to do is we are going to make two columns here. We're going to name one school R, or recode. And so what I'm going to do here is I'm going to recode, instead of using 1 and 2 for the Purdue IU category, I'm going to change it to 0 and 1. Okay, and we'll do that and we'll see why that might be a useful thing to do, why it might make the mathematics a little, or the analysis just a little bit easier. So there's a simple way to do that. Since they're currently, the values are 2 and 1, if you see down here, then it just means to get it to be 1 and 0, we should just subtract 1 from this column of rows, or sorry, from this column of entries into the database. So I'm just going to highlight that cell, C2, and then I'm going to hit minus 1. And so we end up with equals C2 minus 1 being our function. And it converts that 1 to a 0. And then you can just do however you like to copy and paste. You can right click here and do copy. You could hit Control C on this cell, or you can just move the cursor right over to this bottom right corner and you can drag, and that'll copy paste the formula. So now we have a row full of zeros and ones, and that works fine. And so now we would have to remember our data coding is no longer valid, right? So 1 is no longer Purdue, it's now 0. Okay, so we would either want to change that with a note here or just keep it in mind since it's kind of a small demonstration. For the gender, where we recode it, the data, it'll be a little different. Okay, there's no mathematical formula that lets us convert F to one thing and M to something else. And so what we're going to do here is we're going to use an if statement. And so let me open up, bring back my PowerPoint file. So the if function just says, it says it's one of the most popular. This is a screen grab from the Excel help file. It lets you make logical comparisons. So basically what you have to figure out is give it some condition, some logical condition. If this thing matches up to the condition I give, then do step one. And if it doesn't meet that condition, then do some alternative step. Okay, and so that's all that an if function is built to do. So it's very flexible. It says basically, and here's my notes, if the condition is met, execute the action. If that condition is not met, go to the next instruction. Okay, and so that means every if statement has sort of a true and a false outcome. If it's true, you get a direct effect of the executing the action. If it's false, the program, Excel, or the function if, knows that it should proceed and find the next instruction. And so we'll see when we do this one and when we do a nested if statement that that's a very powerful way to think about data and way to convert data into the most useful type. Okay, so for this coding, I'm going to go with an if statement. So the way to start it is equals if, and then an open parentheses, and then you see here, it says logical text, comma, value of true, comma, and then value of false. Okay? And if you didn't put the value of true, the value of false in there, then it just evaluates with a 1 or a 0 for true or not. But we're going to fill it out with the full statement. So what we're going to do is say if the item in E2, right, so it, look at that cell E2, is equal to, and now we need to find a way to put in F. And so the way to get Excel to read F and to know if a character is matching is to use parentheses, or sorry, quotation marks. So we'll hit open quotation, or the first quotation mark, type F, hit another quotation mark, and that's our logical test. That's the first part. So if E2 is equal to that F character, then we'll hit the comma. What do you want to put in there? If it's true, I'm going to ask it to type in a 0. So the female coding for this column is going to be 0 for F. And then if it's not true, if that cell doesn't have an F, I'm going to put a 1. Okay? And so if we close the parentheses then, we have all the conditions, all the arguments for the if function built in, and we see it coded to be 0. So now I'm going to copy and paste. And now, because this is fairly small, but you should do it even with a large data set for a few sample pieces just to see. So the zeros match with the Fs and the M matches with the 1, so it looks like I coded that correctly. If you have more than one category, you'd have to do more work. You'd have to think about a stronger version of an if statement. And we will get to that in a little bit here. So we've been through now the if function. So we've got the data in a nice format. What are some of the things we might do? We already know that one of the things we want to do is count the data. We want to count how often Purdue versus IU appears in our data set. And now we can go back and change our gender bins to, 0 and 1. And we can get rid of the frequency function that was listed there. And let's go out here and we'll type F and M. The gender bins are now going to be 0 and 1. And so let's redo our frequency function that we wanted to do before. So I've got the frequency with an open parenthesis here. The data array now is going to be over here on the gender recode column. The bins array is going to be right here, the zeros versus ones. We'll close the parentheses and let that function occur in that one cell. Now remember, we have to copy, we have to highlight the cells next to all the bins to get them all to fill in. Hit F2 on your keyboard or however you get the second function key to work on what you're using. Hit F2 and then hit Control, Shift, and Enter all together. And you get that filled in. And so we see we didn't just have a 50-50 split and people going to Purdue, we had a 50-50 split between male and female. Okay, so we've summarized the counts in the data by category at this point, so now we might want to move on and do some basic descriptive statistics. So again, I went into the Excel help file and cut out some different pieces. So what we see here are the average function, the median function, the mode function, and then one more mode function here. So you know what all these are. They're measures of central tendency. They give you sort of the middle. That's what central tendency means. What's the sort of middle or representative item? The average takes all the observations and adds up their total value, divides by the total number observed, the median, finds the 50% break, right, where half observations lie above and below, and then the mode finds the most common value. This mode.mult is a new one, a new function, and we'll try that one as well. But what you'll see is it's pretty common in data like we're looking at to have more than one value be the mode, and so we're going to observe how that function works differently than the older more common mode function. Okay, so we have data like this organized in a row, and this is really our new data, so I might want to copy over the IQ because I want to see everything together. So I'm going to just put a new column here called IQ, and I'm going to say it's equal to the old column that had IQ in it. Okay, so this is basically me building a new table over here on this side where I have all my observations now in usable format. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to do some central tendency measures here. So the first one I'm going to do is the mean, and then I'll do the median, and then we'll do the mode. Okay, and so we'll calculate these at the bottom. So for every variable that is described in a column, the bottom will give us the summary measures. So how do we get the average or the mean in Excel? We type equals average, highlight all the values, click enter, and you have it. And once you've typed it in, the average function in for one column, you can cut and paste it and you'll get the average across all the columns. For median, you do equals median. Again, you highlight all the cells, so from K2 to K19, close the parentheses and hit enter, and again you can cut and paste and you get all those values on that side. And now for the mode, you just type equals mode, open parentheses, again K2 through K19 needs to be highlighted, and you close it, and then you copy and you paste it. Alright, so when we get to the mode, we find one, there's a problem with this column. We already know what the mode is. The mode is either female, or sorry, is either Purdue or IU. They're both equally likely or equally represented. It's 9 of each. Same thing for male and female. We know that there's just as many ones as zeros. So Excel is just defaulting and saying one of the modes is zero, and we'll give you that. And we have no way of knowing that, but it may be important in a large data set where you have 3 or 4 categories to know if two things are equally likely and both represent the mode. And then we get no mode out here because, well, it's numerical data, and none of the values get repeated, so we don't have to worry about that. But what I did want to show you is this mode new, or maybe we go mode 2. And that's how to use this multi-mode. And so if you look, when you type MO, you'll see that there's mode mult, mode single. If you wanted to restrict it to just the single mode, you would use that second one, but I'm going to use the second, this one right here, mode.mult, and click there. And I'm going to close it and hit enter, and you still get a zero. That's because it's an array function. Because it has more than one mode, we need to give it two cells, one to write the first mode in and one to write the second mode in. We could do the same thing here. Okay, that's just saying we got a mode here, we got the next mode here, we might have another one here if there were more than one category. And so let's do the mode mult again. So I'm gonna go there. Click it for this, for the gender recoded variable, click enter. And now to get the array function again, we have to highlight multiple cells, hit F2, and then type control shift enter. And so this time I use 3 cells because I don't know how many modes are going to be in the data. So if you have 5 categories, it might be smart to highlight 5 different cells just in case they all happen to be equally likely. You'll recover that information. And so what this is telling me is, well, the first mode that I'm able to calculate is 0. The same number of occurrences happen with 1, and when it gets to a third one, to a third potential mode of this data, it says not applicable. So that means that we hit the limit. There are 2 modes in this data. So not terribly interesting, but something that may come up, something you may be able to make use of in your own analysis of data. Get a couple other things up here. So the median of this data is found to be 0.5, and same thing here. That's interesting because 0.5 is an impossible value for both of those columns. Okay, and so that's one of the drawbacks of the median for category data. When you have category data, it's either going to be 0 or 1. It's going to be those integers. And so it's telling you the median is 0.5 when that's an impossible value. So what happens is on one side of the median you have all zeros, on the other you have all ones. And so it becomes kind of a useless measure. Oops, deleted too much. For this kind of category data. So basically that's something we might want to leave out, and then so we can calculate a median and it might be the best measure for IQ, but for these categories of data it won't be very good at all. Down here, knowing the mode is much more important than knowing the median, which has no information, but knowing the mode for the IQ data doesn't really tell us much. In fact, it won't even produce a mode. And so that's why I wanted to cover this a little bit, to get into different types of data. You have a survey that you've been working on, but because the most common way people see mean, median, and mode compared in your basic statistics class is to think about skewness of the data, think about sort of what the peak of some data distribution is and whether, you know, most of the observations lie on one side or the other, and how do you compare, right, the where the mean versus the median versus the mode sit, and that tells you right skewed and left skewed. But they all have uses when you start thinking about categories of data, different types of data that may exist. 1-0 data that reflect categories, it can be very important to know when to use which and when they mean something. Even the mean here doesn't tell us much, except for because we know we have 0-1 data here, when the mean shows up to be 0.5, it tells us that we certainly have a case where we have half the data in the 0 category and half the data in the 1 category. And so that's kind of useful. And you see here, the median lies above the mean, so you can start to think about how this data, these 18 observations, might be skewed towards above average, IQ measures. Okay, so so that gets us into something I want to look at, and that's another function. It's called average if, and it means exactly what it sounds like. If something, we've already been through the if statement, we've been through the average statement. Well, this is a combination or a this is a compound function. It says if the values I show you fall within a certain range, or if they meet a certain criteria, then calculate the average of them. If they don't, then don't calculate the average. And so what this means is that we could go through in our data, pull it back up here, we could go through our data and say, if someone went to Purdue, what is the average IQ? If someone went to IU, what is the average IQ? If someone went to, if someone's female versus male, what is the average IQ? And you could do those comparisons. And so that's what I want to get into next. So what we're going to do is we're going to make another recode of the data that gives us 4 categories. And so we'll think about that, how to recode that to get the 4 categories with a compound if function. And then we'll apply that average if formula to think about how could I get 4 estimates of IQ. One for males that went to Purdue, one for males that went to Indiana, one for females at Purdue, and one for females at Indiana, and so that I can compare those. And so that's, let me pull the slides back up. I think that's the next slide. Yeah, and it's something we call a crosstab. Okay, so I imagine you might have seen these. I imagine there's an easy way to do them in Excel that I don't know about, maybe. They're definitely in statistical programming. So maybe you've seen Stata or eViews or something like that in maybe one of your classes, or SAS. I don't know what they teach in Stat 301. But Crosstab is one of the most popular things to use with category data and even data that doesn't show up in categories, where you have income or wage of someone, and you put those into categories, the highest earners versus the medium earners versus the lowest earners, and try to describe different categories of the data. I have four categories listed here, so what we're going to do is build our Crosstab by, again, using a recoding of our data. We're going to use a compound if statement, if I can figure it out, so that we have category one, our first category that we'll label as zero, is Purdue and Mail. The category represented by the numeral one will be IU and Mail. Category two will be Purdue and Female. Category 3 will be IU and Female. Okay, so if I can remember how to do this, and if I don't, you'll see that it can be kind of a struggle. But so here we'll go with Crosstab recode. So this has given us a two-dimensional category. So when we get this one coded, 0 will mean one thing, 1 will mean a different category, 2 will be a different category than that, and 3 will be the last category. Okay, so I said 0 is Purdue and Male, and so we sort of start with that one as the target. So that means we need an if statement. Okay, and so the first part of the if statement is a logical test, and so Purdue is going to be our first category. So if they went to Purdue, we'll have we'll be in one category. And then if another statement, right, because going to Purdue doesn't get you into any of our final categories, it just gets you into one of the two tracks in the category. And then if you went to Purdue and your male, right? So if the school record is one thing, that needs to say if K2 is equal to 0, okay, finish that in, and if L2 is equal to 1, then we're going to code that as 0, okay? So it's basically saying test first this, then test this. And if all that holds to be true, then give it a 0. But if L2 is not equal to 0, what value does that take? So at this point in this nested if statement, we are definitely at Purdue. And if that is equal to 1, it means it's male, and we're going to categorize it as a 0. But if this is false, that means it must be a female that's at Purdue. And so we can put a 2 there. And then we can close this little piece of the if statement off. Okay. And if it's not the case, right? So this is what to do if you're definitely at Purdue. And if you're not at Purdue, then we need to come up with an if statement that says male versus female. Okay. So we have if at Purdue, do this if statement. If you're not at Purdue, go over here and use this if statement. Okay, and so that means these are the cases that are going to show up where the school is 1. And so again, we'll use L2, and we'll say if L2 is equal to 1, then we want to give the value when we have a male at IU, which is a 1. And if not, we want to give the value that's a female at IU, which is 3. So we'll close that if statement. And then if you look back, if you track your way back, you have parentheses around this if statement, parentheses around this if statement, but this one hasn't been closed yet, and so we have to close off that parentheses. So we close it off, and we hit that. And our first situation here is a female, right, at Purdue, and we get a 2, and that was what we were intending to get. I'll copy that down the whole way, and I get some 2s, some 0s, some 3s, some 1s, and we have, here we have, this category is a male at Purdue, which is 0, which is what we wanted, and so maybe it's a good idea to put the new categories down here. 0 is Purdue male, 1 is IU male, 2 is Purdue female, and 3 is IU female. And yeah, you can go up here and we can check all these out. Okay, and see that they all match up. Okay, you may have other ways of doing it. You may want to make a column. I mean, if the nested if statement isn't your thing, then it's pretty easy to make first a column that splits things out into ones and zeros for one thing, and then maybe do a math statement or, you know, whatever works for you. But this nesting of if statements, which, let me just talk you through it again. This idea of matching up and saying, if this condition is true, then I want you to evaluate this and do the categories 0 and 2. But if that statement isn't true, move over to this if statement. And so it's a little complicated, but it's quite a useful thing to wrap your mind around. Nesting these if statements, it lets you do a lot with data that could be a lot with data that comes to you in a format that you may not prefer. Okay, so now we have our categories, 4 bins here, and if we wanted to redo, so I've got my 4 bins, I've got this here. If I wanted to redo the frequency count, then I could do it here, and so we'll go equals frequency, highlight the data array, highlight the bins array, close, and now I know that I want to include all 4 cells right by the bins array in this. I'll hit F2, Control Shift Enter, and you see we have this breakout. So we have 5 individuals. Male at Purdue, 4 male at Indiana, 4 female at Purdue, 5 female at Indiana. Okay, so I don't know how much information we want to take from that or what kind of analysis, but I did say that we would want to count up these things, and so we've got that done. And then the next thing, or the last thing in this lab, is I want to look at the average if function. Okay. Okay, so we have 4 categories here, and now we're going to try to calculate the averages using this average if function. You can look it up in Excel's help, which I usually just go to here and say help or type help on some function, but I'm going to show you how to do it. And so the way this works is we go with equals, and then you type average if, and then open parentheses. And so it's basically, it gives you the information here, but it's a little, it's not obvious exactly what to do. You can get help on the function, I believe, by clicking on this if you want. But here's what we're going to do. So it's basically saying, where does the if statement come from? And so we're going to use our crosstab column here. And so I'm going to say, look at N2 through N19, okay? So look at this column of data. We'll put a comma there. And now I need to give it that criteria. So what criteria is going to determine whether you are in this average or not. And so this is where it gets kind of goofy. That I'm not sure what the rules are exactly, but the way I learned to do it was type quotation marks, type equals, type zero, and then close it off with another quotation mark. So basically between those quotation marks, we are giving it the condition, if you look in this column right here and you find a zero, then include it in the average that I want you to calculate. If you don't find a zero there, leave it out of the average. So we need one more comma, and now we need to actually tell it where to go calculate the average. If we don't tell it to go to IQ, it'll just calculate the average of every time it finds a zero, which just gives us a zero. So here we get to type in the actual data range. So the last thing that we want here is this column of data on IQs. So basically this is saying, average if says, look at my crosstab column. Every time you find a zero, include it in this new average that I want calculated. And the value that I want calculated an average for is in this column under IQ. And so we'll hit close parentheses and we'll really hope that I hit it right. And it says it's 91.95. You can test that out and make sure it worked. But that's basically saying the IQ of males at Purdue is 91.95. Which assumes, right, that we haven't made any mistakes in something like this 0-1 category. So 80, 85, 90. Okay, so these all look small, so it all looks reasonable enough to me. Now, this function has a lot of parts in it that don't really change. So I don't know if you know about absolute references to cells, that kind of thing. But if you hit F4 while you have a range of cells highlighted, it'll add dollar signs in front of the row indicator and the column indicator. And what it does is it locks those values in for any copy and pastes that you might do. And so that's what I'm going to do here. And then I'm going to drag the formula in that cell down. And we're going to get the wrong values first, because it's going to keep calculating the value when it's zero. But I can edit this formula up here in the formula bar. I can double click here and edit it right here. And so the second category I want to calculate an average for is one. Okay, so this says that the IU males are 110.7. I'm going to put this one at category 2. This says Purdue females 96.85. And here we put a 3 and we get IU females 112.9. And I swear I thought this was, I completely mixed this up. So I made this data up to seem like Purdue was smarter than IU. And I just got them completely backwards, so these were supposed to be the other way. So, okay, well, this is easy to fix. So we just go down here and we say one is equal to Indiana, and then we say two is equal to Purdue. You don't have to make these edits. And then we just have to change our mind about how we code this stuff, because we know that all the smart students are at Purdue. And now we've got proof with made up data that students at Purdue are smarter than students at Indiana in terms of IQ. Okay, so sorry, I tried to make a cute, fun example, and I got it completely backwards there. I went to the University of Kentucky, so I hate Indiana University just as much as all of you Purdue students do. Okay, so we've got our data here. We've got our practice done, and I think the last thing in the lab exercise is making a couple of graphs. So how would you take the results you get, or the information you get, and try to do some analysis, make a graph. And so that's what I've done here. These are just column charts. Five people at Purdue, four at IU, of the males, four Purdue females, five IU females. And then because, and here you can see that I did screw up my data. So a column for the males at IU, males at Purdue, females at IU, and females at Purdue. Okay, so let's go back to our spreadsheet and see what we have here. So okay, so the easiest way to make these kind of graphs, and again, you should have encountered this before in some other class. I just usually start by highlighting the numerical data, go to insert, and I pick the kind of bar chart I want. So this column chart here is good. It makes it, it looks like a histogram. You click it, and then you can make it a little bigger to look at. And then if you right-click on the chart and click Select Data, it'll let you do edits to it. So you could edit it and say something like IQ by school and gender for that. And then because the column 1, 2, or these 1, 2, 3, 4 don't really mean anything, you could adopt these labels here. And so that'll replace the labels used on this side. And now you've got something that's a little easier to look at. Okay, and so we've got our Indiana-Purdue comparison for males, Indiana-Purdue comparison for females. And then you can do whatever else you want to do. So that's really the end of the demonstration. Let me get back to the PowerPoint and show you the assignment that you have, what you're supposed to do. And so, completing the lab. So we have the lab video as sort of your replacement for class, and then we have your own assignment is what we'll call take home quiz one. And what it will be is use the data from the wiki. So everybody's supposed to have input their survey data into the wiki, and you can use the steps or techniques from this lab. You can use your own. Lots of people use Excel and have their own way of doing things, and so I don't want to discourage you, but I hope that, you know, and if you have a better way and you want to tell me about it, that's fine, but the main thing is the analysis, right? So start looking at these things in comparison form and start thinking about how you might look at the output, how you might look at a graph like this or the one that's in my spreadsheet. This one has different values. How you might use that to make some kind of claim, or to at least start thinking about what needs to be tested, what needs to be evaluated. And so with your data on beef versus chicken consumption, you'll have the opportunity to do that. Here are the important parts. If you need help with Excel, obviously you're allowed to work with other people in the class to try to get this done, and especially if you know somebody that could help you with some of the Excel parts, that kind of thing. You should provide written answers on your own, but the however you like to learn is the best way to go about learning. The important part is to experience this and go through everything. This will be due August 28th, so I believe that's Monday. You need to type up your submission. Don't print directly from a spreadsheet. Cut or copy your graphs out of Excel and put them in Microsoft Office Word or whatever, something better than Excel printouts, and print them there. And then you're asked to type an explanation. So you're going to produce three graphs if you look at the assignment. Two are directly given to you, so they'll be the same for everybody. And then the third one, basically I say you have all this data, you know, think of some question and investigate it using your data, okay? And so you'll have three graphs with three short explanations of what's going on and what you see in that graph, and that'll be our assignment, or that we call take home quiz one, and you can read that more fully in the document. Okay, so that's about 50 minutes on the video lab here, so we'll close this thing off, and good luck getting through the new data and the assignment.